young man, really? Youngish. Oh, everybody looks youngish. Okay. Welcome, Carol.
Do you need me to use the mic?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's hard following the bad budget news and the mayor. But good afternoon, and thank you for this opportunity to provide testimony regarding BOCES as a model for delivering taxpayer savings. I know I speak for all community colleges in New York, if not for all higher education institutions, when I state that reducing non-instructional costs is of tremendous interest to all of us. At Jefferson Community College, we believe that there may be small areas where we could benefit through additional shared services. But before going into those, I want to describe the many ways Jefferson Community College already takes advantage of different mechanisms to reduce costs. We participate in a SUNY consortium for our electricity prices. Jefferson County includes the college in their bids for natural gas, providing us savings over what we could accomplish alone. We use the State University of New York CECAS Center for computer software support, which saves us significant personnel cost. We also use the State University of New York iTech Center for computer hardware support. And again, this saves us in personnel cost, but more importantly, this saves us in major hardware cost and network redundancy. As you've heard several times, we participate in the Jefferson Lewis Healthcare Plan for our faculty, professionals, and management staff. And for our classified staff, we participate in Jefferson County's health benefits program, which they administer. Our collective bargaining for both of our unions is led by Jefferson County, which avoids the college needing to retain its own negotiator and its own labor attorney. Jefferson County provides our snow plowing services and also road paving at a price that we could not achieve on our own. One area where we think the BOCES model may be very beneficial to us is in purchasing. We do already utilize state contract pricing for all of our purchasing, especially for technology. On the technology front, quite often we get favorable pricing just being an academic institution, in addition to be able to purchase from organizations on state contract. We also, as a member of SUNY, are able to take advantage of additional aggregate buys and contacts through the SUNY university-wide IT contracting office. This office works to negotiate contracts on campuses of things we might be interested in, and the more campuses that sign up, the better the price. And as a small campus, this is a tremendous benefit to us. So the contracts include everything from software to hardware. And this center surveys the campuses frequently to review draft contracts and to also find out the kinds of services that would be appropriate for us. We also have a library, which takes advantage of SUNY contracts, and we also use the North Country Library System Consortium for some products. So as you can see, there's a lot of collaboration that's already taking place outside of having a BOCES available to us. We'd be very interested in any mechanism that could further lower technology pricing if that is possible. Despite all the ways we save money, it is a significant cost to our institution. But we're interested in any purchasing agreements where we could realize the savings. We do have some relatively low dollar amount contracts or services where we do not utilize a consortium, and thus we might benefit from the BOCES model. An example of this I know mentioned by Jay Boak earlier was trash services, and that would certainly help us. As a small community college, our administrative offices are typically one person, and that operation handles a multitude of tasks. Using BOCES for benefits administration would save a person in that kind of situation a few hours a week. Using BOCES to run payroll would save us a few hours every few weeks. Most of the time and effort related to benefits administration and payroll is in setting up and managing employees, which needs to be done by campuses in the context of their own labor contracts. And in a setting like ours, with many student workers and many adjunct professors, we spend significant time every week managing this. So I don't see that utilizing the BOCES model in this area would save us any staff or cost, but it would, however, allow us to do a better job serving the faculty and staff of the college by that small reduction. While I'm in general very supportive of this concept and support your efforts here, I do have two major concerns about Jefferson Community College utilizing BOCES for services. The first is, I know you're going to find this surprising, the first is that the State Education Department regulations over K through 12 are rigorous, and they also are significantly different than the regulations over community colleges, which are also rigorous. I'm concerned about a situation where the college would now be required to meet additional standards and regulations because of an affiliation through BOCES. This would increase cost and not decrease it. The second concern also ties to how unique the community colleges are in the state. We are, as you have heard, the only community college supporting Jefferson and Lewis County. While there are some commonalities between us and the public schools, there are also very significant differences. If BOCES is providing services to many public schools and only one college, I am concerned that our specific needs would not be met. We believe that services such as purchasing consortiums would have the most direct benefit to us, as they do not require any party to have a detailed understanding of the other. In conclusion, expanding the BOCES model could provide some cost savings for Jefferson Community College. In this time of tremendous financial challenges at the state and local level, small cost savings can make a big difference. Thank you again for this opportunity to speak with you today.
Thank you very much, Carol. So interesting, because we've been hearing the reverse of what you just said, which is, well, if we let in municipalities and we let in colleges, I mean, our core mission was to serve our student population, K-12, and will that diminish, will that, you know, make it less, you know, substantial for, or will that interfere, will they try and get people on our board who are going to, you know, just look at the municipality or just look at the college. It's really quite funny. But I would think that it will stay, the core message will stay. This is an educational alliance, and if you can figure out a way that would save you money by joining with us, we welcome as many as possible to join.
That's right, and that would work very well for us. You know, we would be concerned if we were forced to have to go that direction on without being able to shop and see what is in the best benefit fiscally for our institution.
Okay, Senator Opke?
Well, I guess just,
Well, purchasing is the largest one, and any, you know, things like a shared service. I know that Jay was speaking earlier about summer and you know, groundskeeping. We don't benefit from something like that because we have a year-round staff, because we offer classes year-round. And so after talking to him, I kind of explored what else could we do. A service like trash would be helpful. Recycling programs could be helpful. You know, already, as I said, we do use the county on, you know, paving and roads. But anything that, you know, requires large equipment, or, you know, intense periods of staff for any reason could help us. But because we are an annualized operation, we actually might have a staff that we could offer at certain times of the year as well back to BOCES.
Do you know offhand how many students in the 16
of the 18. Right. Right, and we have actually three different mechanisms we use. We have a concurrent enrollment program where it's a face-to-face course that is taught by a high school teacher that has been certified to teach at the college level. We have interactive television courses that are taught in a technology classroom with a college faculty member and a small number of students at multiple locations, and those are discounted for students. And then we do have a number of high school students who come to campus to take coursework as well.
So, any idea how many students
the high school, I wish I brought my enrollment report. I was just looking at it this morning. The high school enrollment this year is approximately 425 part-time students. And then we actually have around a dozen students who are taking enough coursework with us to constitute being full-time. How many of those students then come on to us?
Yeah. Okay.
Most of them do. I mean, we heard earlier before you got here, you know, people talked about an example of their child took 10 credits and then went elsewhere. But the majority of the students who do the concurrent enrollment come on to us for at least 1 year after.
Do a percentage of your students then continue on for a four-year degree?
About half of our students transfer to go on for a four-year degree. We do. We have agreements, of course, across SUNY, and then with, all of the area institutions, Clarkson, Syracuse, but the big schools that our students transfer to are Potsdam, Oswego, the more local colleges. Could I add a couple of more pieces of information? We're talking about demographics because hearing so much about the declining populations up in the schools. We had been seeing quite a bit of declining enrollment at the community college as well, and that's been a real challenge for us because I'm sure you're aware that the state funding is very enrollment-based. So when you are declining, it is a terrible, terrible problem. At the community college level, we're really proud that this year we're up 12% over last year. And that's true across the state, and you will hear, I believe the average across the community colleges is about 9.5% to 10% of the SUNY community colleges. And so that's great for the short run, but it is a concern when you think about this demographic and the numbers of students who are graduating from our schools and, the problems that we have keeping people in this area as to what the future is going to hold in terms of the number of students who turn to community colleges in these areas. Well, I think a lot of it is the economy. Daryl, as you know, I've been at the college 2.5 years, and I came with a grow enrollments mandate. And so we have undertaken many initiatives that were designed to grow enrollment, better outreach to the high schools, more marketing, some easier processes for students to be readmitted, many more services to help at-risk students, and many more services to help students who are struggling keep the grade point average up. I do wish the economy was better for a lot of reasons, but I'd love to see how much we actually achieved based on our own hard work as opposed to the economy as well. So it's a combination, but certainly the economy is a big piece of it.
And when you were told to do your best to increase your enrollment, who gave you the assistance and guidance? Was it central staff or assumed?
No, it was the Board of Trustees who hired me with that, and I think part of why they were interested in me as a possible president for the college was that I had experience with enrollment management, and I also had an MBA, so they knew there was a business background there as well.
Me too. Well, thank you very much. That was very interesting, very informative. Thanks. Oops, I think we have. Oh my goodness, 20 minutes early. Does anybody have something that they desperately want to say to us? Because we're finishing 20 minutes early, and I'm opening the mic.